Hi, and welcome back to Mingis on Tech. I'm Ken Mingis, Executive News Editor for Computer World. It's Tuesday, February 7th, 2017. I'm here with Senior Writer Lucas Mirian, Multimedia Editor Keith Shaw, and we're here to talk about the technology of the Super Bowl game. In fact, we're here to talk about the technology of drones used by Lady Gaga at halftime. Not really.
No,
we're just here to laugh about the fact that the Patriots came back from an amazing
team. We just defended a lot of our audience.
But we should know we are in Massachusetts, and therefore we're a little bleary-eyed, but very happy.
Oh yeah.
And still stunned that that game turned out the way that it did.
I mean, at one point, I said to my friends, I said, "Well, at least we're not biting our nails. We know it's a done deal. They've lost. We can just sit back and, you know,
and relax,
commiserate
until the very end of the game.
Until the very end, when the robot Tom Brady brought it home."
There's your tech. All right, there's your technology angle. Robots do exist. They're named Tom Brady.
That's right.
What we want to talk today about is a little bit of emerging tech. Lucas has been writing about energy technology for us. And he recently had a story about floating solar, which just really caught my eye because it's the first time I've ever heard of anything, you know, like that. And so we're going to talk about that for a minute, and then we're going to catch up on VR, AR with Keith and see what's going on, whether there's anything really there or whether it's just hype. But first, floating solar.
Floating
solar. All right, just enlighten me, pun not intended.
So we all know real estate is expensive.
Yes.
Just about anywhere in the world. And that's really what floating solar is all about. It's predominantly developed in developing countries and nations like Japan that don't have a heck of a lot of land resources. And so they're looking to put floating solar, the panels that are
so floating. These are the kinds of panels basically that you would put on a building, yep. Or you know, you see them along the highways or whatever.
Yep.
They've now figured out a way to sort of put them on top of bodies of water.
Canals, reservoirs, sewage treatment plants.
I can see why you might want to cover that up.
There you go.
You know?
No, places you especially don't want to look at.
Right, exactly.
You don't want to be the tech that has to go underneath. Figure that one out,
well,
right?
There are some problems with emerging technology.
These wires attached underneath.
Yeah, right, exactly. So this is something that you said seems to be emerging in like places like Japan, where land is very expensive.
Yeah.
So they're trying to find basically alternatives to land. You've got water.
Yeah. But also, interestingly enough, in places like, land would be probably pretty limited in the UK as well. But places like Brazil and China, because China is kind of leading the market in a lot of ways with photovoltaics.
Yep.
In fact, today they announced that their news service announced that they are now producing more solar energy than any other nation on Earth.
Not surprising given how big they are, yeah. And how many people they have, but it does seem like, you know, there's been this real push in the U.S. over the last few years to make sustainable energy sources more cost effective.
Right.
You know, and in fact, isn't solar now the largest employer in the U.S.
Yes.
In the energy tech?
Yes,
field?
It is. In the world, actually.
In the world?
Yeah. I believe it's in the, I better not say that. I'm going to say, I'll stick with the U.S. It may be, probably just the U.S. considering, you know, how much we produce for coal and whatnot. But
right.
It's leading in the U.S. Job producer, and it's the fastest growing energy in the world.
Well, what caught my eye was, you know, you had the details about how fast the market's going to grow. It was 13.8 million in 2015, but it's expected to be 2.7 billion by 2025.
Yes.
I mean, now again, 2.7 billion in the larger scheme of things, it sounds like a lot.
Yeah.
It's not, but when you look at that kind of growth over the next 7 or 8 years, that's a pretty fast takeoff.
And, I mean, that's what you have to keep in mind. Like when China says they're the largest producer of solar energy with, I think it's 77 gigawatts, they doubled it last year. It's still less than 1% of their total energy production. So it's great. It's going to get there eventually, but right now in the big picture, it's still a relatively small slice of all overall energy production,
right.
But an important one. I mean, we need to get there. And for people who say, "Well, it's, you know," they scream, "it's subsidized." Well, guess what? The oil,
all
fossil
subsidized.
Fuel industry has been subsidized for decades. Hundreds of billions of dollars have been poured into an industry that arguably doesn't need it. So,
right.
Screaming about how renewable energy is being subsidized by governments is ridiculous.
Yeah.
They're not getting a sliver of that pie compared to other.
So, I had a question about the the floating part of it.
Yeah.
What are some of the kind of things that the people have to think about when using solar on a water versus, you know, just kind of setting up a solar farm on a land or, you know, that kind of stuff? Like, do they have to worry about the water type, salt water versus fresh water? And then obviously there are other things that live in the water. How do they prevent like a whale from coming up and destroying it, or an evil whale, or a mad whale?
Jaws.
A shark.
That's right. Yeah. Well, they need to charge their iPods too, so sometimes they try to hook in. Did I just
say
iPod?
An iPod of whales.
Welcome to 2000.
Wow, an iPod of whales.
That just
rolled
off the tongue.
Right.
No, actually, the seagoing solar, floating solar, isn't as viable.
Because they've got
tried.
The wave action.
Because
those
the wave
are
action.
Going to be up and down like that, yeah.
Yeah, it is being done, but in much smaller ways.
Okay, so these are calmer bodies of water then?
Typically landlocked bodies of water.
Canals.
But
lakes,
interestingly
ponds.
Enough, if you're putting it on a pond or a lake, it reduces algae production. So it can actually be healthier for the water.
So the algae fans will not be happy, you know, at this turn of events. You know there's a group out there. I'm sorry. A
little banner that says go algae.
but for canal use, you know, yeah. there was a canal in the UK, project in the UK that recently got completed. And I was looking at photos of it. And it's kind of interesting because so they build it up over the canal and ships and boats, whatever, can still go through it. But they got a little bit of shade as you're going through.
What's interesting, though, and this goes back to Lucas's story, is that one of the things that's an advantage of being on the water is that you actually get more reflectivity of sunlight off the water, which the panels can then collect.
Yeah.
And you also have the cooling effect of the water, which the panels can take advantage of. So there are some advantages here that
right,
are not necessarily
I think
there on land.
On the land ones, like some of these have caught fire because of the heat that's generated, right? There's been some fires at some of these.
That's concentrated solar, which is a little different.
Okay. Yeah, that's the like mirrors that reflect up to
it's
a
like
tower.
A steam generator. Same thing. It's a steam engine. Basically, yeah. and the solar is being concentrated on molten salt, more often than not molten salt, but sometimes water, and that generates steam to turn a turbine.
Okay.
Anyway, so that's the update on floating solar, a concept I hadn't heard of until last week, but we're going to be hearing a lot more of over the next few years. Keith, I want to switch gears and look at virtual reality and augmented reality. We talked about this about 6 months ago, and at the time, you know, we were all impressed. I had one of those little cardboard viewer things, and I was looking at some of the virtual, you know, things that are used with the phone. I don't even know where my cardboard viewer is now. I've kind of forgotten about virtual reality. So I'm trying to figure out, is this something that's still actually going to happen? Is it just hype? Is this like the 3D TV of 2010 that in 5 years no one will be thinking of?
Yeah, I'm not going to say that kind of the hype is over. I think there's still a movement.
We love hype.
Yeah, there's still a movement for VR in consumer use, and we're starting to see enterprise usage of it. But I think that after 2016, which saw a huge amount of hype,
right.
You also saw a lot of products come out too. Sony especially came out at the end of the year with their PlayStation VR and their gaming, and I think that drew the wave from like here up to here.
Yep.
And now I'm getting a sense that we're going to kind of level off a little bit until we see some more products, and then it'll either go up or it'll start to either plateau or go down.
Are we sort of waiting?
I'm kind of in that little bump because, so, you know, January was CES.
Right.
And I spent a lot of time on the show floor. Half of the floor in one of the halls was VR. The other half was drones. So you know that those are the two big areas where you're getting a lot of people. But there's a lot of interest in there, but there are still some pretty big hurdles in order to get it from a niche market, whether it's the gamers. Now, that's a pretty big niche market.
Right.
We're talking about gaming. To that next level of where everybody's comfortable with it, everyone wants to use it, everyone likes what they see. And I don't know if we're there yet because so this is the Royal Moon.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about
it's
that.
It's a virtual theater. It's not an actual VR. It's more about like you put this headset on. I'm going to take my glasses off, but you put this headset on, and then you can then watch a movie from like so. This is connected to a box somewhere. there we go. So there's like video content on here, and then I can watch a movie. And these are noise canceling headphones. The cool part about this headset is the touch controls.
Yeah.
So I can then navigate the menus with my finger, and I could go up in volume, and it goes. You know, you kind of go up or down on volume. You tap to basically move on the menu screens. But what I'm disappointed about is that the fit is, it pinches my nose on this.
Okay.
This is supposed, you're supposed to be able to wear this without glasses.
Can you not adjust that, though?
There's some adjustments, but I think right now this unit is a little bit too heavy, and okay. The company's going to send me another mask that helps. This is called the immersion mask.
Yeah.
They're going to send me, they've redesigned it to be less pinchy.
Who
on
makes
the nose. This is a company called Royole, R-O-Y-O-L-E.
Okay.
Their main business, in fact, are the sensors, the touch sensors. So I would say that they're going to take this technology, license it to other makers.
Right.
And they'll make a lot of money on that. But this was just their proof of concept of the touch sensor.
So it's basically an entertainment device.
Yeah. So, you got a bunch of movies, you got music, you want to listen to it on a plane, you kind of bring this out. The other problem, though, is that this is tethered via wire. And a lot of these other headsets, like the Oculus Rift, things like that, they've all got these bulky wires, and you've got to kind of connect it to a big PC system.
Right.
The movement in that space is to try to get rid of that, those wires and cables. And so technology like 802.11ad, which is in the 60 gigahertz space, very high data rates.
A lot of bandwidth.
Very low distance.
Okay.
So you can't walk from one room to the other and then expect to have your connection. But for VR, where you're going to be in that space, you can do a wireless between that and the computer.
So if you're, say, maybe in one room.
So that all of the
and you don't leave the room,
right.
Then the wireless would work.
Right.
But if it's, I mean, that's the sort of thing that again, if they could make it wireless, truly wireless,
right.
And allow you to sort of explore whatever environment you're in,
yep.
Then I can see how it might take off. But again, all these limitations that right now, I just wonder if the technology is still...
Yeah, it's basically the wires and then the fit on the headset to make sure it's comfortable on your head, and then the issue with the optics in terms of people that wear glasses, and I think they said like 70% of the world has corrective lenses, whether it's either glasses or
I'm not alone.
Contacts. Good. So you got to kind of fix those three hurdles, and then the content too. You really need to have engaging content.
I don't see wireless as distant wireless as big a problem because, I mean, unless you're going to walk around with a cane in front of you, you're going to be tripping over furniture.
So ideally, if you had augmented reality, you could see where you are with something superimposed,
right?
Would
okay,
give you sort of best of both worlds.
I think when you talk about mobility of this, it's going to be augmented reality where you have a camera that you can then see what's in front of you. But another big trend.
A speeding car, for instance, if you're stepping out into the street.
The other big trend is with these things called depth sensors. And so at CES and some other company announcements, Intel is making a lot of noise in terms of the depth sensors that they're creating. So if you go down to the processor level in some of these sensors, you're going to start seeing like, The headset will trigger you when you're about to walk into a wall or something like that. Right now, you set it up with tracking cameras. Like, you set up, like, these giant poles, and then they can tell you where you are, and they create that virtual space.
Mm-hmm.
So I would, that's another trend to kind of look to.
And like sort of like smart VR, which knows where you are and can then give you feedback in real time.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in my mind, I keep seeing a Dick Van Dyke over the ottoman somersault, you're walking along.
Yeah. Hey,
yeah, and that's an issue. That's why most of these games that require some sort of movement have you do it in a space that's all...
A safe space.
A safe, yeah.
We need to be in our safe spaces.
A padded room.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and again, and then whether or not they can make the jump to enterprise use or, work use, I still don't see me going back to my cube and putting this on and doing my work, but there are some interesting applications that are being developed on that space too.
It'll have to give you something that you don't get now in your real reality.
Yeah.
Something augmented or, and I guess, so the hype is there. Obviously,
but I think
the technology,
it's a little bit of a down slope. I think we're all kind of like,
I'm not hearing as much about VR as I was 6 months ago or a year ago.
Yeah, I think we're just waiting for some more content to come out and then maybe some more equipment, and then as they adjust the equipment.
Let me ask you something. Is there something that you might compare this to that hasn't taken off the way that the industry thought it had? Like, I don't know, smartwatches or something like that. Is it something that
curved
there's a
TV
lot of
screens,
hype
curved
about,
TV, 3D TV. I think a lot of the 3D stuff that came out, people didn't want to wear the glasses. But
right.
I think, again, most of the people that came out with the hype, then they scaled it back a little bit. And now 3D is just if you're going to buy a new TV, it's, do you want to pay an extra $100 or $200 for the 3D, or do you want to just kind of wait till the prices come down on that again and then say, all right, I guess I'll watch it.
I think 3D TV is dead, though. I think they pulled it. Basically.
It's an add-on, you know. I mean, they're not really pushing it anymore. Not, yeah, you get it for free if you want this particular. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think they actually some of the companies have actually just killed it.
Just killed it.
Yeah, they just said
he's still getting at the movies, and then these, and again, a lot of the 3D content you can now kind of see on these things too. Yeah, I would say. Again, it depends on your comfort. I don't want to wear this all day because of the comfort right now.
You did the roller coaster thing, didn't you? Though? Yeah. The amusement park ride with one of those, which I would have needed a barf bag, but I guess you're
a virtual immune
barf to
that. Bag.
Well, okay. So not only was that more enjoyable wearing it on the roller coaster.
I'm just thinking of the concept of a virtual barf bag.
Virtual
what could possibly go wrong? Anyway, sorry.
Okay.
We've lost the show.
We're blur. Okay, yes, we have.
At CES, there was another company that was showing off a chair that you sit in.
Yeah.
And they were doing a demo. You put the headset on, but then the chair moves with you.
Oh.
So then, and again, the idea is that your brain, when you're sitting in a chair that's not moving, you're more likely to get motion sickness. But when you're on the chair that moves left and right with the virtual, then you don't get as sick.
So what your body is feeling is it reflects what your eyes are seeing, and therefore the disconnect doesn't make
you're
sick.
You're tricking the brain in a better way than when you're just tricking it when you sit down and not moving.
All right.
It sounds counterintuitive, but
I see a future like, you know, the residents of the spaceship on WALL-E, where we're all just basically sitting in chairs and we never get up.
I think we're almost there now.
It's going to get, yeah, that's going to be predictive. Yeah, we're all going to be, well, I don't know if you and me and
on that dystopian note.
Maybe our grandkids will be those kids that don't move at all.
All right, so hype, hope, still evolving. We'll check back in 6 months and find out where we stand.
I'm pretty sure I won't be on the show.
Maybe one of these days we'll all be virtual here.
I'm sure I'll be on the show before 6 months, but we'll talk about this.
Oh, you will be, but then we'll talk about this then. All right, Lucas, thanks for the update on floating solar. Thanks for the update on virtual reality. Thank you, Tom Brady, for a great evening.
Yeah, go Pat.
Well, that's a wrap.